Okay, so everybody,
where is yours?
Okay, so everybody can see my screen?
Yes, we can.
Okay, so not by no means all of stochastic thermodynamics. There's very important parts of it that do not have to do with these kinds of systems, but a lot of it is applicable to basically any system where you've just got a continuous time Markov chain. There's been extensions also to discrete time Markov chains, and there's also versions of stochastic thermodynamics, very important stuff. Massey's did a lot of background work on it, sort of Chris Jarzynski. Gulje is doing some work on it now, where you don't have a stochastic process at all, but everything is instead Hamiltonian dynamics. But a large part of stochastic thermodynamics, if you want to know what's going on, can be understood by just saying that you assume that your system can be modeled accurately as evolving according to just a linear differential equation. The probabilities of stochastic process, first order Markov, about the simplest continuous time stochastic process you can think of. In particular, you can model the dynamics of a Turing machine this way, the noisy dynamics of a gate in a circuit, the noisy dynamics of an entire digital circuit that comprises gates, spike trains going down axon, neuronal assemblies communicating, basically close to everything that people right here in this conference are interested in, their dynamics can be modeled as such a master equation. So this is actually kind of, this is one of those things that in hindsight, it's so simple. It's amazing that it wasn't done earlier, but starting several decades ago, I'm not quite sure exactly how the process started. Christian van den Broek was associated with it. Masa, you might know some of the details, but in any case, people said, in essence, just for fun, let's assume we've got this kind of an equation where we allow the rate matrix to evolve with time, by the way, and let's just see how the Shannon entropy of that distribution evolves under that dynamics. A very, very natural thing to think about. And you immediately get this result. It takes maybe a page of algebra. Time derivative of the entropy of a distribution, if it's evolving under this rate matrix, is the sum of two terms. This is going to be central to very, very much that I'm presenting today and central to a lot of stochastic thermodynamics. The first one, I'm ignoring details here. I'm ignoring the subtleties of what's called local detail balance and multiple mechanisms and so on. This is much more at a high level. But nonetheless, this first term is called the entropy flow rate. And that's going to be amounting to, you'll see, it's going to be heat that's going to or from heat paths. Or in general, if you have other reservoirs like particles, it's going to and from particles. If you have reservoirs that are things like voltage sources and so on and so forth, those kinds of things can be bundled up in what's called the entropy flow rate. This second term here, notice that what goes in here in these sums on the right-hand side, these are the rate matrices from right there, and these are the probability distributions. So this thing is evolving in time as P of T evolves in time. Here is a modification of that formula. So this is the entropy flow rate. This one here, the entropy production rate, it's actually identical, except that you've got these two, this ratio of probabilities inside the log. You can work it through that the sum of these two terms, because you're assuming it's a stochastic rate matrix, is the time derivative of the Shannon entropy. This is the heat flow and so on to your reservoirs. This is the irreversible entropy production of the entire universe. This is your thermodynamic inefficiency. This is the fundamental cost. This is what I will argue is the essentially the only thing that's important up at the level of digital computers and brains. Crucially, it's very straightforward to prove that this term here, it's non-negative. Doesn't matter what your rate matrix is, how it varies in time, this cannot be less than zero. So given that, let's just integrate over time. So remember, here's the decomposition that we just saw. We integrate over time and just move things around. You get a negative of delta Q. This is over any particular time interval that we've integrated over. The total heat flow, depending on your condition, your convention to or from the thermodynamic reservoir, is equal to the difference between your total entropy production and the change in the entropy of your system. So delta S is the gain in Shannon entropy of your system. This term is the entropy flow between these two times if we're integrating from 0 to 1. And this, because that cannot be negative, nor can its integral. This, in essence, you can view it as basically in two pages. I just derived the second law of thermodynamics. Not completely. There's lots of caveats. This really is a limited domain. It's not applying to everything and anything like Clausius does. But nonetheless, at first pass, this is the second law of thermodynamics. So what ensues from that? So this is basically it. If you're not stochastic thermodynamics, computer science, neurobiology, you know this slide, these two slides, and you know a lot of what you need to understand how we can maybe apply stochastic thermodynamics to understanding computational systems in the brain and in digital devices. So here's like an example of applying all that. A lot of people here will have heard of the Landauer bound that erasing a bit costs kT log 2. That's mostly true, sort of. Again, Rolf Landauer was working in the day when they only had equilibrium statistical physics, so he didn't have the tools to fully nail down the full formula. The full formula is not what's now sometimes called the generalized Landauer bound. Let's say that your system is actually connected to multiple reservoirs. For example, heat baths at different temperatures, so that kT, what occurs in Landauer's bound, it's not even defined, because there's multiple Ts. Say you have an arbitrary number of states. We're not just concerned with bit erasure. We're not just concerned with what happens to a single bit. An arbitrary initial distribution. Landauer, somewhat implicitly in some of his papers, more explicitly in others, he assumed that the initial distribution over states is uniform. Whatever your system of interest is, if it's a gate in a computer, if it's a paramecium in a pond, in reality, the initial distribution is almost never going to be uniform. Initial distribution of the states of the system. And now let's also allow arbitrary dynamics. So we're not just talking about things like erasing a bit. Well, let's now plug into this particular formula. Entropy production is non-negative. So therefore, this gives us the generalized Landauer bound. The entropy flow, negative delta Q, is greater than or equal to the drop in entropy of your system. And in particular, if you assume what's called local detail balance, then that delta Q term can be related to the actual heat flows. It's, the entropy flow can be related then to the heat flow in the sense of thermodynamics, energetics. So to give an example, this is actually the conclusion of Rolf Landauer. Let's say the system evolves while connected to a single heat bath at a particular temperature. Then the heat flow into the environment, it's negative kT times delta Q. In this particular case, let's say there's two states only, uniform distribution. The process implements bit erasure, which means that the distribution at the end of the process is a delta function about the erase state, but it's uniform at the beginning of the process. We assume that technical condition was called local detail balance. Then generalized Landauer bound says the total heat flow into the environment is greater or equal to kT log 2. Which was Rolf Landauer's conclusion. It's a special case of this more general result. So if you look at this formula, right away it actually tells us something very interesting concerning real-world computers. P0, let's say that your system has its states X, is a brain or a digital device or a set of concurrent processors, a sensor web, whatever you want. The initial distribution of it before it starts doing the computational processing, it's going to be fixed by the user, the environment, previous computations. It's basically not going to be under the control of the engineer or only indirectly under the control of the engineer. However, the ending distribution is going to be partially under the control of the engineer or natural selection, as the case might be, because it is what is produced by hitting the initial distribution with this conditional distribution, and that is your physical system. Your physical system is bound up in this, the conditional distribution of ending state given starting state. So given that your initial distribution is fixed, that means S of P0 is fixed, but you can control S of P1, because you can, to a degree, you can control P of X1 P given X0. If you look at this formula, what that tells you is that the greater the entropy at the end, the less the total amount of heat that you need to generate. This can be viewed, if it's analogous to, if it wants to be really careful, but in a certain sense, it almost justifies from first principles, the need, how it is that we can reduce the heat flow in real digital devices by what's called approximate computing, where we basically weaken the bounds on our transistors to allow more errors because we're allowing this term here to grow. It's not exactly the case that that's what's going on, but to a very large approximation. In the case of a human brain, what this means is whenever I can do a noisy computation rather than a precise one, whenever it's not fitness relevant for me to really nail down exactly what the result of the computation is, it will save me energetic costs. It will save me the amount of heat I generate to be as noisy as I possibly can. Okay, that's all well and good, but let's now start to think about things, do some calculations. The heat flow into the environment, as I just mentioned, it's for the case of a single bath, the temperature T, it's negative KT delta Q. And this is the Landauer's bound term. So if you take negative KT, you multiply it times both sides here, you get negative KT delta sigma plus negative KT times the drop in entropy, and that's Landauer's bound. KT is a really, really small number. At the scale of real computers and brains, this is teeny. Essentially, it's irrelevant. Landauer's bound is relevant. Now, notice this is an equality. It's not like a bound, like the conventional Clausius equality. This is exact. So what that means is that in real computers and brains, this delta Q, which is huge compared to this, is all being determined by the entropy production. That is the crucial aspect of stochastic thermodynamics as far as analyzing digital devices and things like brains, or for that matter, cells or what have you, is concerned, I would argue. In turn, delta sigma it's got minimal values that are determined by the constraints on your physical system. So constraints on your physical system give you lower bounds on delta sigma, and that then is the dominant thermodynamic cost. So I would say, one of my perspectives on things, that we need to understand how constraints, the real ones in these digital computers and our brains, not just the ones that we've got results for, like the thermodynamic uncertainty relation and so on and so forth, how they actually contribute to and delta sigma, because that's what really matters. Okay, so to give an example of how constraints actually set the minimal entropy production. These are results now that they're very hot, so to speak. There's tons of work going on these things. Some of the people involved in this conference are doing seminal work along these lines. One of the ways that a constraint can affect your system, this is a performance constraint rather than a constraint based on what materials you have to use. Let's say that you want your system to have a very precisely specified what's called a current. Now, in stochastic thermodynamics, they use the word current a little bit idiosyncratically. A current is the generalization of what you and I would think of as a current, electron flow or water flow from one position to another. If you've got a trajectory of your system that's evolving stochastically, this is one particular trajectory for a stochastic process, so all trajectories have non-zero probability, the current for that trajectory, there's many, many different currents. It's any function of every state transition that is odd under time reversal. So that's many, many things that qualify as a current in this particular sense. So a whole body of results that's being now generated and is being researched very, very deeply, very, very deep results. They are telling us under many conditions, for example, if your system is in a steady state, you have what's called, a bit of unfortunate terminology, a thermodynamic uncertainty relation, which basically says the following. Let's say you want your system to perform it. So Jessica, you have a question?
You should unmute yourself.
It's maybe not a quick question, but just something to put on the table. is what is understood about the overlap between concept of current here and a causal relationship in the Pearl sense?
I would say probably close to nothing. That's a very good point. So you're thinking in particular of like Nihat I and Dan Polani, their information flow based upon the Pearl. Yeah. That's really interesting because there you're actually interfering with the stochastic process. The Dew operator is, of course, defined by changing the underlying Bayes net. That's a very good question. So far as I know, unless somebody else on the call has a different answer, nothing is known about that.
So I think it's kind of critical because, you know, when you think about circuits, they're actually, I often use circuits in a causal sense, but it would be great to, but I also mean this kind of current that you're talking about here. So I think if one could make sense of that, that relationship, we could make a lot of progress.
Yeah, that would be very interesting. So mostly my full disclosure, my only thinking about the circuits and stochastic thermodynamics has been where the circuits are something like a digital circuit. It's not been something like a causal circuit. I mean, there is, for example, there's a paper on the thermodynamics of Bayes nets, but there's nothing like a Dew operator.
Right, but there is in our work. So our social circuits and the neural circuits that we think about, empirically, there's overlap. So, right? So we use the circuits in that Dew operator sense.
Yep. Definitely hold that thought. It might make sense even for a breakout session question. But if at a minimum, it'd be good for you and me to actually just talk about that later.
Okay.
That was an excellent question. There's now many, under many conditions, and this is a very, very quickly expanding list of conditions and the precise details over here. But under many conditions, we have what's called a thermodynamic uncertainty relation, which is saying that basically, so remember, because you've got a stochastic process, your trajectory is a random variable. That means the current is a random variable. But let's say that you want your total current from, say, time zero to time one to be statistically very precisely defined. I want to know that the net number of times a particular neuron fires is 17,623 plus or minus only two. I want to really have that current be nailed down. Well, if you look at this right here, this is what's called the statistical precision. This is the average of the current squared divided by the variance. And if you're going to have that kind of a really high precision, this term over here on the right-hand side is going to be large, which means that you're going to have a large minimal possible entropy production. So to get a highly accurate number of times a particular neuron fires in a second, you are going to pay for it thermodynamically in many, many conditions. And this is, as I say, a very, very quickly expanding set of conditions that these kinds of results apply. Notice in terms of people who are familiar with predictive coding, both Carl Friston's version of it and the earlier things like Peter Diane, the Helmholtz machine and so on. What this is saying, it's kind of turning things around, putting it on its head, that if the variance in your predictive coding error signal, that's a typo, shouldn't have been S there. But the variance is small, then if you're going to have small expected errors in your predictive coding, then that's actually a necessary condition to have small thermodynamic costs. In other words, if I don't have much variance in the error signal in the predictive coding, then I need it to actually be an accurate predictive code in order to reduce the thermodynamic cost, which is kind of a flip of the way that people very often think of things like predictive coding in terms of functional organization in the human brain. Okay, speed limit theorems. This is another one. Again, I can't emphasize enough, this is an inequality and it applies just as well up at the scale to which we live as down at the scales of quantum dots and organelles in cells and so on and so forth. P0, again, that's fixed by the initial distribution. What we can do is set a P of x1 given x0. Speed limit theorems, this is a body of results that say, let's say I want to implement the same probability distribution of the ending state given the beginning state, but I want to do it more slowly. So I want this to be the distribution that's implemented not from time zero to time one, to time zero to time 10, let's say. That can actually reduce, in many situations, that will reduce your minimal thermodynamic cost. And one version of this is to say, to be a little bit more precise, if we are transforming one distribution at one time to another distribution, the greater the total variation distance between those distributions, the further apart they are for a fixed time, the greater the total entropy production. And as you reduce that time, this lower bound in the entropy production goes up. So this, and there's many other results of this general flavor, would basically tell you that if you're going to be doing the exact same computation but more quickly, it will cost you an entropy production. And of course, that's a phenomenological dogma in computer science, is that it's why your laptop, for example, the chips in it right now, they are clocked down from their maximal clock rate to reduce the total thermodynamic cost of implementing the same computation. It's why in high-performance computing centers, where you have many parallel computers operating, very often the computers that are going to be completing the computation first, they are adaptively clocked down, they are slowed, so they don't get the result before the other ones, because the slower you can run your computation, the lower the thermodynamic costs. Looking at this in terms of things like the human brain, there's some computations I've got to do very, very fast. If I see a tiger walking through that door, I've got to do a computation very fast of what my actual action should be. But there's other computations that I can do really slowly. It doesn't really matter. Yeah, I want to get the result, but that can wait an hour. The more that you can be slow and slovenly, so there's an advantage not just to being noisy, like we saw before, but there's also an advantage to being lazy, which is the way that I like to think about justifying my own behavior. Anyway, so yes, the faster you change the distribution in the brain region, the larger the entropy production has to be. Clock rate in your laptop is slowed. Parallel computers are slowed. Okay, there's all of what I was just presenting, that all had to do with the situation where I've got a fixed initial distribution, and I can now change my stochastic process that will implement some conditional distribution. I'm trying to find the one that will minimize entropy production. And I find that, oh, well, if you want to have it be at least this fast or this precise or what have you, here's your minimal entropy production. So those are all the cases where you've got a fixed initial distribution and you get to modify your system. In many, many scenarios in the real world, it's actually the other way around. It's not the initial distribution that's fixed and you get to design your system. Rather, you've got to design your system once ahead of time and then be able to use it in many different environments. For example, a cell, if you design it once, and it is sensing its environment and performing computations based upon that, you put it into a different pond, a different environment for the same fixed cell. That's the actual problem that we need to understand. How is its thermodynamics going to vary for the same fixed system if I put it into the same environment? If I right now design my computer once, and then it can either be used where the user is David, who sets up the initial distribution over states one way, or I can lend it out to Jessica, and she can be the one who's using it, and she'll have a different distribution. So it's really the other way around. We very, very often, we have a fixed physical system and want to see the dependence on the initial distribution rather than the other way around. Well, it turns out that there's some problematic properties of doing this kind of a thing. So let's say we've got an arbitrary dynamics of our system. Let's assume that's thermodynamic reversible. In other words, zero entropy production, we're down to Landauer's bound, when it is run on some initial distribution Q0. What happens if we instead, so this is, for example, a paramecium that's thermodynamically reversible if you put it in one pond, or the laptop that's thermodynamically reversible if its initial state is being set randomly by David, choosing what to type on the keyboard. But now let's actually run it with a different distribution. That fact alone means that you've now got a non-zero lower bound on the entropy production. So if Jessica borrows my laptop and it was optimized to be thermodynamically reversible for me, Landauer's bound is reached for me, that will not be the case if she uses it. And the actual formula modulo some details. Essentially what it says is that this is an equality that the entropy production, if you run it on distribution P0 when it was optimized for Q0, is given by the drop in the KL divergence or relative entropy from the beginning of your process between your idealized distribution and the actual one, versus if they've both evolved under your fixed dynamics, what their relative entropy is at the end. And by the data processing inequality for relative entropy, this is non-zero. So this means, to give a simple example, let's say we're talking back about bit erasure, just like Rolf Landauer did, whatever, like 60 years ago, I guess. And let's say we have two separate gates, for lack of a better word, that they just consist of a single bit and they erase the bit. And let's say they both reach the Landauer bound for whatever, for some initial distribution Q0. Q0 could be uniform for both of them, doesn't matter. So they're both thermodynamically reversible for some distribution Q0. If we run, so that means that each of them separately generates no entropy production. If we run them in parallel now on two bits, which can be statistically coupled, then that means that the joint system in general is not going to be thermodynamically reversible and it's going to generate non-zero entropy. What's going on here is that if these two initial states are statistically coupled, then if the distinct bit erasing gates, they're just running, one of the gates is running on XA, one of them is running on XB, neither of them is paying attention to the other one. So what that means is that by the end of the parallel bit erasure, you've actually lost all the information about the original coupling between XA and XB. You can't get it back. That is, formally speaking, what's called dissipated work. What this means is that you have two distinct bit erasing gates, that each is thermodynamically reversible, but if you run them in parallel, then in general, you've now got non-zero entropy production. And this phenomenon applies not just to bit erasing gates, but any set of gates in any digital circuit, any set of neurons in any brain, you're going to be running into the same phenomenon. And this is actually formally a version of that problem with the initial distributions that I was mentioning in the previous slide. Okay. So that's the intuition. And a broader version of this is there's lots of reasons in both designing digital systems and brains that you want them to be modular to reduce the communication wiring costs in order to make them be more robust. There's a huge literature in biology about why modularity makes things more evolvable and so on and so forth. But if you make a system be modular, then you unavoidably increase the entropy production, the thermodynamic cost of that. There is a trade-off between modularity and entropy production. And essentially nothing is known about that trade-off up at the level of architectures of brains and circuits. Okay, so get into some applications for all these things. Well, Turing machines, I'm not sure application, but it's a theoretical application. So probably most people on this call know what on this conference know what a Turing machine is, but let me just review why it's important and what it amounts to so we're all on the same page. There's many different abstract models of computers, but Turing machines are particularly important. One might even argue the most important one. Computational complexity is formulated in terms of cost to Turing machines. Part of that is because of the what's called the Church-Turing thesis. It's a very, very odd statement. It's not something that you can be, it could not actually be validated. It could only be refuted. And it has to do with how we interpret words, dictionary definitions, much as anything else. But nonetheless, it's a touchstone of computer science. Every function which, quote, would naturally be regarded as computable by a computer, by a brain, but whatever you have, is computable by a Turing machine. And there's lots of subtleties involved with this, especially when you get down to quantum computation. Scott Aronson's got some good videos and a really nice paper on the different flavors of the what's sometimes called the physical Church Turing thesis. Okay, that's fine. But what do we mean by a Turing machine? So just to remind everybody, the simplest version of one, there's many ways you can formalize it, but you've got some bi-infinite string of bits, sometimes called a tape, and here's the bit string. You've got a head, which has n internal states, one of which, in the generic, the most vanilla version of a Turing machine, is called a Holt state. But each time the head is located above one of the particular bits in the bit string, and the that bit value is s of bt, and at each particular iteration, based upon the current state of the head and the actual bit that it's above, the head does three things. It changes its state, it writes a new binary value to that bit, and then it can move by up to one bit in either direction on the tape. The computation might never end, but if it does end, it is the definition of when the computation would end is at any particular time if the state of the head enters a Holt state. So it enters the Holt state, and at that moment you pull the plug, computation's over. The associated computation is the map from the initial bit string to the bit string at the time that the computation ended. Okay. As I mentioned, it's the standard model of computation that basically the Python interpreter on your laptop, it's a Turing machine or can be extendable to be a Turing machine and so on. Turing machines have some fascinating properties. I would actually say that some of the deepest philosophy humanity has ever uncovered has to do with properties of Turing machines. I would argue that in some senses, nothing comes close, to be quite honest. To what we know is called algorithmic information theory. But in any case, here's one of the cute aspects of Turing machines. Almost all binary valued functions of the bit strings cannot be computed by any Turing machine. Powerful as they are under the Church-Turing thesis, they are everything that we can ever do. They are measure zero in the set of all binary valued functions. Turing machines are the basis of something that's a very, very important concept. This is where a lot of philosophy, as mentioning, comes from, called Kolmogorov complexity. The Kolmogorov complexity of a bit string, this is a bit string that's supposed to be the output of a computer. So it's saying, I want to compute something, I want to know the complexity of that thing I want to compute. And its definition is, it's the minimum number of non-zero bits, input bit string, that causes the Turing machine to produce that output and halt. So for example, if I want to use the Python interpreter in front of me to compute the first 100 digits of pi, then the Kolmogorov complexity for that, that particular Turing machine would be the minimal program that I can feed into it such that it produces the first 100 digits of pi and then stops. Very common measure of how complex a bit string is. It's related to Shannon entropy asymptotically. But unlike Shannon entropy, it's actually gives you a way of measuring the complexity of a single string rather than a distribution over strings. It itself, the Kolmogorov complexity, is uncomputable. Gets back to Hilbert and his whole program and Gödel's incompleteness theorem and so on. No computer program can actually calculate the Kolmogorov complexity of an arbitrary string. Okay, that's all well and good. Another way to view the, to make this be anything to analyze Turing machines in terms of thermodynamics, we have to specify an initial distribution over the states of the system. And the way this is done implicitly in algorithmic information complexity is that you say the probability of any particular string is just given by coin flipping, that you just flip a coin at each successive bit in the bit string, and that's how you actually set the random initial string. From this perspective, the Kolmogorov complexity of a bit string is the minimal length input string to a given Turing machine for it to compute the output and halt. In other words, by Bayes' theorem, the Kolmogorov complexity is the most probable input program given that the output of the program was your particular string. Okay, that's all really cool, really deep. I very, very highly encourage people to read this textbook called Leah Vitani. It will open your eyes. But arguably, it has nothing to do with the real world. Real Turing machines, like that Python interpreter in front of you, one of the things we're most interested in is what is the thermodynamic cost? How much free energy do I need to burn? It's not just what's the minimal computer program that I need to put into my Python interpreter to get it produce the first 100 digits of pi. I want to know what's the minimal amount of energy it will burn, the minimal amount of heat it will produce to produce that to produce the first 100 digits of pi, where again, that might not be the program that's shortest that results in the smallest amount of heat produced. It could be some other program. So you can go through and do the calculation, and what you get can be viewed, depending on how you want to interpret the term, as a correction term to Kolmogorov complexity. The minimal heat, so while we look at the Kolmogorov complexity of continuum with string, the minimal amount of heat flow out to the reservoirs by any physical system, your Turing machine computes that bit string, is given by the Kolmogorov complexity plus two other terms. This one is a normalization constant. That's actually a partition function. It's called Chaitin's constant. It itself is an amazing thing. This one particular constant holds in it the answers to every mathematical question we might ever formulate. But that's a different talk. This right here is the probability of having that output be generated under the coin flipping distribution. So this is what the thermodynamic complexity of a bit string is, as opposed to the Kolmogorov complexity of a bit string. Intuitively, what is determining this is the cost of the many-to-one maps in the state space of the Turing machine as it evolves. Go back to the thinking of things like Landauer's bound. Landauer's bound is saying you erase a bit, it costs you heat flow. That erasing of a bit means that you have a many-to-one map. It's not logically reversible. That's why you get the minimal heat flow in Landauer's bound. There are many many-to-one maps in any Turing machine as it's evolving. Basically, if you sum up those many-to-one maps, that's what's driving this. This could almost be viewed as Landauer's bound, generalized Landauer's bound, extended to the case of a Turing machine rather than just bit erasure. It also has some really interesting behaviors, differences with Kolmogorov complexity. Kolmogorov complexity is unbounded, meaning that if I just look at them, there is no constant that exceeds the length of the shortest string to compute some particular output for all outputs. There is no minimal size RAM that you need on your Python interpreter to be able to make sure that it can compute any output string that you might want. In general, you've got to be able to go out to disk and maybe even buy some more RAM and so on if you want to be able to compute any possible string, because the Kolmogorov complexity is unbounded. In contrast, the thermodynamic complexity is bounded. There is a constant that exceeds the minimal entropy flow to compute any given output for all outputs. In itself, that constant is uncomputable, but it exists. So this is a major difference between Kolmogorov complexity and what is arguably more important to an engineer, which is the thermodynamic complexity. Now this, the thermodynamic complexity is defined as finding the single input string such that the computation of V starting from that input string would result in the greatest amount of, the smallest amount of entropy flow. We can instead just ask, well, what happens if I randomly choose the input string rather than for the minimal one to compute some output? If you randomly choose the input string, then you can actually use what's called Levin's theorem. Levin is another one of these famous, amazing Russian mathematicians from the mid-20th century. He did a lot of work like Cook and so on with KSAT and all kinds of things. But in any case, using Levin's theorem, you can actually show that even though the minimal heat flow to compute any specific output is bounded no matter what that output is. If you instead generate your inputs to your Python interpreter randomly, then the expectation of your heat flow is actually going to be. So getting a bit closer to the theme of this workshop, how do we extend what we know to all these other issues having to do with thermodynamics, information processing, and the brain, and computers, and so on? We can ask a very simple question. Everything that I've been talking about so far has about thermodynamic complexity has actually been lower bounds, where you've got idealized systems. Tom Aldridge knows, has done some work related to this kind of a question, so has Philip Strasberg. But you could ask very, very much more broadly, how do all of these kinds of results get modified if we've got a more realistic update function, physical system updating the state of the string in your Turing machine? I'm running this Python interpreter on my actual laptop with its thermodynamic inefficiencies, with the fact that I've got this head that's got to move back and forth across the tape that's being modified with time. How does that actually modify these results? Nobody knows. Okay, let's go towards the other end of the Chomsky hierarchy and even then beyond. Let's go a little bit about the thermodynamics of loop-free digital circuits. So these are circuits with no loops, no branches, sometimes called straight line programs. This fellow here, that's actually Claude Shannon. As I mentioned, in addition to giving us information theory, like Athena coming out of the head of Zeus, basically, he also had a lot to do with the early work on the complexity of these kinds of circuits. So in these kinds of circuits, what is well known, Shannon had a lot to do with these results, is that the set of allowed gates are what's called a universal basis. For example, if they're NAND gates, or if they're the set of and ors and nots and so on, then you can build a circuit out of those gates that will implement any desired function taking one Boolean string to another. They are a universal basis. You can use them to compute any computational process over bit strings that you might be interested in. So like here's an example of a wiring diagram of gates that are coming together where you're computing, in this case, a Boolean function that takes 3 bits and outputs a single bit. Okay, cool, that's what a circuit is. What's its thermodynamic cost as far as stochastic thermodynamics is concerned? What does the equality of stochastic thermodynamics tell us about the minimal thermodynamic costs of this particular circuit? And more generally, no matter what my desired map from inputs to outputs is, no matter what my desired Boolean function, there's an infinite number of circuits that can implement them. Which one should I choose if I'm using just thermodynamic considerations? Well, let's start thinking about it. First thing to notice, recall that for any fixed distribution over, say, a single gate of its ending state given its beginning state, if you change its initial distribution, you change the Landauer bound contribution to its cost. You change the drop in entropy. So what that means, now think about it. I give you an AND gate. I can put it into various spots in this circuit. I'm not sure, I should remember. I think these AND gates, I forget, should know this. But let's say that whatever this gate is, I can take one and I can put it in here, I can put it there, I can put it there. Wherever I put that gate, for any given distribution over the initial strings of 3 bits, that same physical system, that same AND gate, is going to have a different distribution over its inputs, depending on where it goes in the actual system. That means that even if it's a thermodynamically reversible gate, changing its location in a circuit changes the Landauer cost of that gate. So even if I take those gates and optimize them for wherever they are by redesign, so even if I make a gate and redesign how it operates dependent on where exactly I'm putting it in a circuit, so it's thermodynamically reversible for that location, where I put it on the circuit is going to change the associated Landauer cost. It's going to change the associated minimal heat flow generated by that gate, which means since I can use different circuits, I can actually, depending on the circuit I choose, implement the same Boolean function with a different Landauer cost. That means we have a new circuit design optimization problem. This is not yet, by the way, saying that issue I was talking about before, where let's say you've got the exact same physical AND gates that you can put into different places and you change its initial distribution that gives you entry production. This is the extraordinary, it's absurd. This is saying, let's say that I know where the gate's going to go into the circuit. I know the initial distribution over bits in the circuit. So let me redesign my physical gate, the physical system implementing that gate to be thermodynamically reversible. So this is extraordinary, it's absurdly expensive to even think about doing this. But even if you could do that, even if you could go down to this thermodynamically optimal extreme scenario, which actual circuit you should use to implement any given Boolean function, it's a circuit design problem. And it's actually, it seems to be an empty hard one. Jessica, you had your hand up? Jessica?
So this optimization is from the whole circuit point of view, right?
Correct. It's a global optimization problem.
Global optimization. So has anyone thought about it from the perspective of the nodes?
Oh, this is the problem. So Max Tegmark has done a little bit of work on a version of it. I did some work trying to figure it out. Josh did some work. It's very difficult. Let me actually now write down what some of the equations are, and you can see why it will be so difficult. Thank you for that lead-in, by the way. Just to introduce some notation. I'm going to write I of a distribution over an arbitrary number of random variables as the sum of the entropies of the marginal variables minus the entropy of the joint. So this is a generalization of mutual information. This is answering your question, Jessica. It's a generalization of mutual information. Sometimes in literature, you'll see it called multi-information, sometimes called total correlation. It's one way of quantifying how much information is actually being shared. That should be almost among these random variables x1 through xn. Okay, what circuit should I use to compute a given Boolean function? It turns out once you you can cancel terms to actually look at it as a difference problem. Oops. Let's say I've got two circuits, C prime and C, that both compute the same function f. Then the change in the total Landauer cost, again, this is not even looking at entropy production. This is way off in the land of idealized systems. The change in the Landauer cost for using circuit C prime rather than C, these are sums over all of the gates of the multi-information of the distribution of the parent gates of that gate. So if we go back here, this is a gate G, and it's got as its parents this gate and that gate, because they're both coming into this one. This gate has only a single parent. This gate has all of these parents. So you go through all of them, you figure out who are their parents, and then you say that, okay, I've got some distribution over the inputs. So I've got some distribution here. That gives me a joint distribution over any subset of the gates. That allows me to say, what is the shared information, the total correlation, the multi-information for any given gate among its parents. And then what you have to do is sum over all the gates. And whoever has if C prime has a lower value of this sum than C, then you should use C prime. So what you're doing, your optimization problem is to try to find that circuit which minimizes the sum over the gates in the circuit of this total information. The problem with doing this in anything that's a local process, the challenge is that if I'm going to make a change up here, that's going to have downstream consequences to the distribution of the parents down there. So it's inherently globalized. You make any change to a distribution in one place, it propagates all the way downstream. And that's what makes this a very nasty problem. As I say, it's not been proven, but I think it's probably NP-hard. So there's this entire field in computer science called circuit complexity theory. Really deep, really cool stuff. We have all kinds of analogs of circuit complexity theory. How does the minimal heat scale with the size of the input space? Circuit complexity theory is how do the resource requirements in terms of like number of gates scale with the size of the input to a circuit? Here we're saying, how does the minimal heat scale with the size of the input space? Answer, nobody knows. Moreover, everything that I just presented was for the Landauer bound. That's saying, again, that we're able to optimize the particular gate for where it is in the circuit. But in reality, I'm going to be using the exact same gate from a big, when I have a big bucket of gates, they're all AND gates. I'm going to put them on my little circuit board and wire them together. I'm not going to modify those actual AND gates physically, depending on where they are. They're going to be identical AND gates, which means you're going to have massive contributions to the entropy production because of that phenomenon of how you cannot erase two bits in parallel without causing, if they're both, without causing some unavoidable entropy production.
Hey, there is a question.
Question.
David, it's me, Manoj. So my question is, so your circuit, as you drew it, consisted of AND gates, which are known to lose information. But what if you had made up a circuit of, say, Fredkin or Toffoli gates, which don't lose any information and are still known to be computationally universal? So would your logic still hold, or do you have a...
Fredkin gates, reversible circuits, Fredkin-Toffoli circuits. I can point you to actually an appendix in the paper that my postdoc Artemy and I did on circuits. Basically what happens is this: if you run a set of Fredkin gates, they are all individually reversible, but when you get to the output, you're going to have a lot of what are called garbage bits, which are going to be in the on the output tape in addition to the actual output of the computation. If you want to reuse your computer, then to make it be an apples to apples comparison, you've got to erase not just your output bits of the output that you want, but you've also got to erase those garbage bits.
Yeah, I get what you are saying, and I agree with you on this. So okay. Bennett has a counter argument to this in his Thermodynamics of Computing paper, where he says, he says you can make the billiard ball square and you can constrain them to be holonomically parallel to the walls of the room, because of which, you know, you will not be in a hyperbolic billiards kind of situation, but you will only accumulate errors linearly based on the depth of the circuit.
Okay, well, so let me just make one quick comment and then we should probably move on. First, actually some very cool work that Charlie did. And then there was subsequent work where people tried to figure out, what was it called? The Pebble game? I forget the precise name of the mathematics. But they used some results involving, I think it was called Pebbling, to try to calculate what is the optimal way of storing the garbage bits so you minimize your costs afterwards. And I think that's some very important papers. But all of that, with the kinds of arguments that you're talking about with the billiard balls in particular, that cannot hold if you reuse your computer an arbitrary number of times, unless you got an infinite number of billiard balls. You eventually run out of space. I should say there are possibly advantages to Fredkin gates that have to do actually much more with reducing the costs of that erasure, not to zero. A lot of it depends on the details of how you run the system multiple times. I would love to talk afterwards, and maybe we can even, I don't know if it would be appropriate for a breakout question or not, but if you and I talk about this later, Manoj, that would be great. And I also would point you to, actually now that I think about it, I've got a really big paper called a review article on stochastic thermodynamics of computation. And it was in a special issue that Takahiro helped put together. I believe it was Journal of Physics A. And it's got a whole section, I believe, on the subtleties involved with trying to use Fredkin gates to do these kinds of things.
Thanks, David.
Was there another question?
There was another question by Tom. Would you like to ask?
Yeah, I mean, not unrelated to Manoj's question, one thing that often confuses me is, you know, as you've drawn that circuit, the input and the output are separate things. The input is a signal on the on the wires on the left, and the output is a signal on the wires on the right.
Yeah.
And the idea that an AND gate is compressing is somehow based on the fact that the idea that the output is overwriting the input. Whereas in this case, I have the input and I have the output.
Okay.
So it's all logically reversible. So that So,
so what you do is you first of all, your state space is actually going to be the state of all the individual gates. So it's the joint state space of your entire circuit, not of an individual gate. And if you keep those input lines all the way through to the end, then yes, everything is logically reversible. It's the simplest way of doing it. You don't need to do anything about a Fredkin gates. If my state space is this entire circuit, then if I just run this through, I've still got A, B, and C when I've done the complete computation. So it's trivially logically reversible because I've still got A, B, and C. But the whole point, it's kind of ironic because Charlie, of course, his solution to Maxwell's demon was to say, consider a complete cycle of the system rather than part of it. But the key for that particular subtlety is that if you want to reuse the circuit, then you've got to overwrite the inputs and you will end up overwriting the output. So it's when you close the loop of the entire system, that's where you would actually get the cost for this particular circuit if the joint state space is the entire.
Right. Okay. So you should, you should think about it at the, it's the fundamental inputs and the fundamental outputs that are the.
Yeah, you've got to close the loop of the cycle. It's just like Charlie pointed out, the solution to the centrioid problem of Maxwell's.
Well, I fundamentally disagree with that solution to Maxwell's demon. Well, but anyway, I see what you're saying in this context.
Yeah, it's the same high-level motivation. You've got to look at the complete cycle. It's standard in all thermodynamics. If you don't look at a complete cycle of your system, then you can do whatever you want. Basically, it's only when you're going to be reusing it repeatedly, that's where you get all the bite. Okay, are there other questions or should I go on?
I think you can go on.
All right, let's see, about 10 minutes. So I'll be skipping over a whole bunch of stuff, but I kind of expected I would have to. I'll try to end on time. So this was, as I mentioned earlier, to try to get this to be at all a tractable for even an hour and a half, I focused pretty much on the kinds of systems that I know best, but there's tons of other work, very important, that's been done by the people on in this conference, actually. If this were a full tutorial, like a couple of days, I would go through all these papers in detail. What a computer scientist might view at what's called a stochastic Mealy machine, a unifilar hidden Markov model, if you're coming from the different community. In the infinite time limit stationarity, there's lots of papers by Paul Rikers, who's here, Alec Boyd, Jim Crutchfield, Dibiendu, Mondo, Chris Jarzynski, who was going to be here, but had to bow out the last minute, Deweese, many others. And it's not only work in the infinite time limit, but there's a lot of the papers that have to do with that. They've also, as I mentioned, recently been doing work on where you have what are called symmetric protocols and the implications of that for control of memories. I should have actually written that down here as well. There's many other machines in the Chomsky hierarchy, of course, besides just Turing machines, and loop-free circuits aren't even in the Chomsky hierarchy, but they're below it, so to speak. But there's also, for example, what's considered to be the bottom of the Chomsky hierarchy, which is more sophisticated than loop-free circuit. It's a deterministic finite automaton. And there's a bunch of work going on analyzing the thermodynamics of these. Tom Aldridge is doing some work involved with analyzing the mismatch costs. That's the business about how if you change the distribution into a fixed system, that gives you unavoidable EP. Gonzalo Manzano and Edgar Roldan, they've got these fluctuation theorems for first passage times of entry production, and there's current work on seeing how those might be extendable to deterministic finite automata. The point being that how long a deterministic finite automata runs, just like a Turing machine, that's a random variable. And therefore, these fluctuation theorems for first passage times, those all have to do with the random variable, how long you run as well. And Gurja Kadesh, who's also on this call, she's doing some work on the relationship between entropy production, number of states in a DFA, the source coding length. So you can take a DFA and you can sort of in certain cases, you can reformulate it as a Markov information source, which means that it actually has connections to information theory. and therefore you have source coding complexity. And there's also a bunch of relationships with generative grammars for deterministic finite automata. Eric DeGuilly, who's on the call, and Max Tegmark have also done some work on, loosely speaking, one might call it thermodynamic properties. It's got to do with like phase transitions and things like that for generative grammars of going up from deterministic finite automata, going further up in the Chomsky hierarchy. So it's not just restricting yourself to regular grammars, but context-free grammars. So all of that work is currently going on, and I don't like this, but I'm sure I'm in the heat of the moment forgetting to mention some things. Oh, here's the paper by, good. I remember to put this in. So that was all for the Chomsky hierarchy, abstract models. People are now starting to really apply stochastic thermodynamics to the deep, very, very accurate models of real digital computers, the kinds of things like my laptop. So some of that work is by Paul et al. On memories controlled by asymmetric protocols and associated issues. And then some very, very much down in the details kinds of work on anomaly electronic circuits. Manuel Freitas and Massimiliano Esposito, who are both in this call, they're down concerning CMOS technology, down to the level of shot noise in the accuracy. It's a recent FISREVX. Magao and Dave Limmer. Dave Limmer is here. I'm not sure if Gao is, but they've also done some work on such circuits, much more realistic than those things that I was just presenting about straight line circuits, which was all very abstract, very cartoony, but not quite to the level of the fine-grained detail of this paper in most respects. So you could view it almost as a middle ground. And I think in the interests of time, let me just mention this without going through the details. There's also one of the major concerns of modern computer science, rather than end 20th century computer science with its focus on the Chomsky hierarchy, is concurrent distributed processes, event-driven asynchronous computers. You can view things like genetic regulatory circuits as an example of them, but they are also things like everything from sensor webs to quite honestly, just your laptop right now has got a lot of concurrent processing going on in it. In these kinds of systems, like in the human brain, it's the architecture of the spatial distribution of the components and the communication across them plays a key role. But aside from that work about the circuits I was mentioning before, very, very little, which is all synchronous computation, very, very little is known about these asynchronous kinds of processes. It's starting to change. Fariya Tazanim, who's on the call, has done some work concerning what are called multipartite processes, which are these concurrent systems extending the speed limit theorems for them. Gojo Kardesh, who's been on this call, has also done some. What's going on with these systems is a lot of the standard results that we have get modified drastically based on the constraints in the rate matrices. So this right here, let me just walk you through this little example. This is a toy model of three systems concurrently processing, so to speak. One is a concentration of ligands in some intracellular medium. And these are two different cell wall receptors that are both detecting that concentration of ligands. So this could also be like sensors in a sensor web that are both detecting some feature of the overall environment or things along these lines. So very, very simplified. The crucial thing is that when these systems are actually designed, they're implemented, the ligand sensors A is paying attention to the medium. It's not paying attention to the state of C. And similarly, the ligand sensors in C, they're not paying attention to the state of A. Those are constraints on the architecture of the overall system that are formalized in terms of the rate matrices. That's system A, it updates its own state based upon its previous state and whatever B is. C updates based upon C and whatever B is. B is just going on its merry way. A is oblivious to C, and C is oblivious of A. Just like parallel bit erasure just like two separate systems that are doing bit erasure, they're thermodynamically reversible, but you run them in parallel. In general, you are now going to have costs. Those kinds of costs exfoliate into a very rich structure when you start looking at these kinds of systems where there's the same kind of thing going on. The key to the entropy production in all these systems is that there's limited communication between all of the different subsystems. It's not all to all. And that actually results in many versions of speed limit theorems and thermodynamic uncertainty relations, extensions of them, and so on and so forth. Jessica?
Yeah, so we've been thinking about how becoming statistically coupled in time might lead to becoming coupled in space, which is the reverse of what you're suggesting here. And I'm wondering if that matters.
Yes. Okay. Thank you. Okay, so you are spot on. In these kinds of systems, they A and C are physically decoupled, but with time they get statistically coupled. The mutual information between A and C, considered by themselves, depends actually on the details, but in general, it's possible for them to become statistically coupled. Another very important set of issues, which actually Jan Korba, my co-organizer, he did a recent really cool paper with Stefan Thurner on what do you guys call it, Jan? Structure forming systems, I think. I think that was the phrase. It would appear in Nature Communication. And it's it seems like it could build into a very, very large body of research, which is exactly the issue that you talk about, that in reality, from a certain perspective, the state space of your system changes when you're in things like biological systems. Cells will find one another, come together, and now make a higher level system, whereas they were separate earlier. Different chemicals in a chemical reaction network can come together and form a higher level singleton. So rather than having the separate chemicals earlier, you've now got a compound that has both of them together. These kinds of state space changing systems, they are very, very common. They're not that common per se. Well, maybe they are, let me be careful. They're not so glaringly front and center in things like digital computers or in sensor webs or in the brain. But they are certainly front and center in many other biological information processing systems. And I wouldn't be surprised that with 5 minutes of thought, you could find all kinds of examples of them in these other scenarios as well.
Well, David, if I can, just to emphasize one more point related to this thread. So we're thinking that it's by coarse graining that changes the spatial distribution. So they coarse grain, they become statistically coupled through collective coarse graining, and then that changes their spatial distribution.
Coarse graining. And in fact, Massimiliano Esposito on this call, he's got a fantastic paper from, when was it, Massi, 2012 or something like that? Basically on the stochastic thermodynamics of coarse graining.
Yeah, I know that paper.
Yeah, and there's been lots of follow-up work. There are lots of subtleties. And so far as I know, in the approach, so Jan, correct me if I'm wrong, but the approach that you and Stefan were using is not coarse graining per se. You're actually changing the state space. But more generally, just the issues that you're raising, they are crucial if we want to understand thermodynamics of hierarchical modular systems. Because one of the almost defining features of having a hierarchy of modules is those higher level modules are coarse grainings, or what's down at the lower level. So these kinds of considerations are front and center. If there are no other questions, here's a whole bunch of issues having to do with the brain. Stochastic thermodynamics of spike train computation, nobody knows. Active versus passive conduction, nobody knows. Stochastic thermodynamics of relaxing Hopf field networks. Actually, Chris has some thoughts on that. And grad student working with me, Ariane Kukowski at University of Maryland. She intends to be working on that soon. Stochastic thermodynamics of sparse coding, decoding, neuronal plasticity, where you're actually changing the rate matrix dynamics, which is something that Gloja has been emphasizing, Vijay as well, nothing known. All these examples, here's some things that where something is known. recurrent neural networks and spin systems near criticality. But even there, there's a whole hell of a lot yet to be done. Let me just whip through this because I guess I'm already over time. But here's a point that I want to just return to. I raise it very early on. In a lot of these kinds of systems we're talking about today, everything I presented about circuits actually was considering just the Landauer cost. It was the SFP0 minus SFP1. There's other work that considers circuits for the entropy production. And that's quite important because at the scales that we're talking about, this delta sigma dominates. The Landauer bound is almost irrelevant for these kinds of systems. But what is driving the lower bounds on delta sigma? It's everything from speed limit theorems to thermodynamic uncertainty relations to first passage time results to the architecture results. An architecture is a constraint on a system. It's a massive constraint on a system when you specify its architecture. And essentially, nothing is known about how that constraint of an architecture, what its actual implications are for the lower bound on your entropy production, even though obviously the architecture is so front and center to other costs that a computer is doing, and for that matter, just what the computer is managing to do at all. So go through that. And because this is going up on YouTube, I might as well go through the bibliography. This is, I guess, a little bit out of date now. It was from the summer, but electrical components used in digital computers, Turing machines, here's some work based on stochastic thermodynamics, earlier work, which was before there was stochastic thermodynamics. This paper by Wojciech, it's fascinating almost, but not quite, I would say. It's very, very deep, having to do with managing to use just the notions of bit erasure with algorithmic information complexity to try to say something about minimal thermodynamic costs for Turing machines. Straight line programs, including Bayes nets. There's a lot of foundational work by Takahiro, who's on this call, and Sasuke Ito. I've done some work with this. Some of my postdoc, Artemy Kolchinsky. Finite state automata, there has been some work that's been already done, especially if you include Mealy machines. Then there's all the earlier papers I was mentioning by Paul Rieckers and many, many others, Devinder Mandel and so on. Asynchronous information processing systems, here's a partial bibliography. On the thermodynamic irrelevance of logical reversibility, this is getting back related to Manoj's question. Perhaps one of the first people to emphasize this was Owen Moroni in FizRevy in 2009. Takahiro Sagawa, he's got a very nice pedagogical paper about the difference between logical and thermodynamic irreversibility. And then I was mentioning, I've got a section in this kind of tome-like review article of mine that looks at the issue. And here's just some miscellaneous papers related to these kinds of things that are all really cool to know about. Relevant computer science, computation biology, computation foundations of physics, and huge as this list is, it's very partial. There's really cool stuff here. Like I love this paper by John Barrow, Kurt Gödel and the Foundations of Mathematics, Scott Aronson papers, so on and so forth. There's a lot of work on neuromorphic engineering, which I've not got on this, and so on and so forth. This is a nice one about the elements of the Chomsky hierarchy in Nature Review Genetics. This qubits work, great name for somebody who works in quantum information processing, qubit, or it was a great name. He had some really cool stuff about uncomputability of physical systems. Naoto Shiraishi recently had some work on that.